The boys of summer look to fall and Charlotte for a little hometown Cup Series run. In the ARCA ranks, he can't be stopped. How will he do in NASCAR? Roger Penske's rolling the dice on the kid he says is a sure thing.
Roger said something to me after my first win at Pocono. He said, just be humble. And I think that's just a way to approach everything that we do.
Stephanie sits in with Ryan Newman. On the Cup side, he's been keeping the points lead to himself these days. Now, the stretch run to the title has the Joe Gibbs Racing Team playing defense.
They're behind. They want to get caught up. They don't want to wish you no bad luck, maybe. But if you do, they want to take advantage of it.
Bobby Labonte in focus. Plus, Andy Houston's truck team goes over the wall. This week, Inside NASCAR.
Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us here on TNN for Inside NASCAR. I'm Ned Jarrett, along with Stephanie Derner and Steve Wade, Vice President of Editorial for the NASCAR Winston Cup scene. Well, the NASCAR action is at the Lowe's Motor Speedway this weekend, the UAW GM Quality 500 for the NASCAR Winston Cup drivers. And that's a track that Bobby Labonte looks forward to because he's had a lot of success at the Lowe's Motor Speedway in the past. He would like to pad his points lead or maybe at least hold on to what he has. Now, last weekend at Martinsville, Virginia, Bobby lost points to the second place driver for the first time in many, many weeks. And so he'd like to pad that lead a little bit again. But the hot hand belongs to Tony Stewart. He's won two in a row now.
Hey, guys, whatever you do, don't touch Tony Stewart. You'll burn yourself. I mean, he is hot.
Things are
going real good at Joe Gibbs Racing right about now. Bobby Labonte is in the points lead, and Tony Stewart is coming on strong. He's won five races this year, including two in a row at Dover and Martinsville. And you got to consider him a pretty good favorite going into the Charlotte event. Tony seems to come on strong during the last half of the seasons. Last year, he won all three of his races and 15 of the final 17 races, and now he's running strong again as we go into the final six events. But it is Charlotte, Stephanie, and when we get to Charlotte, news always breaks out.
Tons of announcements always made at Charlotte. A couple of the major ones this past week, no big surprise. I think everybody knew that Sitco was going to be going to the number 99 car, Jeff Burton and Roush Racing. Of course, that's going to happen beginning this weekend for the remainder of the year. Now, Sitco will remain on the number 21 Fords of Elliott Sadler and the Wood Brothers for the remainder of this year. But next year, it was also announced this week that Ford and its Motorcraft brand will be on that car. Another big announcement this week, also the NASCAR Busch Series finally revealed its schedule for the 2001 season.
Yes, they'll have 33 events, next year. And there'll be two events that'll come off. South Boston, Virginia and Myrtle Beach, South Carolina comes off the schedule. Three new tracks will be added. The Nashville Super Speedway, Kentucky Speedway, Kansas Speedway, and Chicagoland Speedway. And actually, that's four instead of three added onto the schedule. So going into some big market areas.
Yeah, that all makes sense. I mean, no real offense to South Boston, Myrtle Beach, and the Nashville track. They're all excellent for the Busch Series, but the fact remains that the Busch Series needs more exposure, wants more exposure, goes to bigger markets, and what they get in Kansas and Chicago and the new Nashville Super Speedway, all of that brings that to them.
Yeah, and all of those races will be televised live next year for the first time ever for the Busch Series.
That's great for the Busch Series. I want to clarify in Nashville, too, because we mentioned it a couple of times. There is a short track in Nashville, Nashville Speedway USA. That's the track that goes off the schedule.
Right.
And the new Nashville Super Speedway is the one that goes on. Of course, the NASCAR Winston Cup Series is at the Lowe's Motor Speedway this weekend. For all the latest news, Bud Poll qualifying results, and race results from the NASCAR Busch Series, log on to NASCAR online at NASCAR.com. We're just getting started here on Inside NASCAR. Points leader Bobby Labonte joins us in focus later in the show. But first, we'll review his saga at Martinsville and its effect on the standings. That's next. Stick around.
Inside NASCAR is brought to you by Mopar Parts for the Chrysler, Plymouth, Dodge, and Jeep vehicles and the dealerships that sell them. And by Meineke Discount Mufflers, where you won't pay a lot, but you'll always get a lot. NASCAR. And now the Castrol GTX race preview. The motor oil that provides maximum protection. Castrol GTX. Drive hard.
The NASCAR Winston Cup teams are at the Lowe's Motor Speedway this weekend for the UAW GM Quality 500. With six races left on the schedule, tension is building as the points chase comes down to the wire. And while Martinsville could have been disastrous for Bobby Labonte, the points leader rallied to escape relatively unscathed. Here's a look back at the NAPA Auto Care 500 in this week's race recap.
The NASCAR Winston Cup Series made their final short track appearance of the 2000 season. To Martinsville we go. Tony Stewart had the privilege of leading the first lap, but it was Rusty Wallace who showed the way through lap 54. The beating and bumping began early. Ken Schrader helped Stacy Compton through turn three. This, the first of 13 cautions. It was a tough day for Little E. He lost 10 laps after this flat, and then later crashed while racing back to the yellow trying to get one back. Later, he could have used a bud with this barbecue. Ward Burton's engine only made it to lap 63. He finished dead last and recorded his third straight DNF. The hardest lick of the afternoon? That went to Hutch Strickland. After losing his brakes, he allowed the concrete to slow him down. This gave the leaders a chance to pit, and Rusty, who came in with a flat, came out in 20th place. Surprisingly, he was never able to make up the lost ground and ended up 23rd, two laps down. Lap 206, Jeff Burton by Tony for first. Three laps later, Ricky Rudd takes the lead. Lap 282, Bobby Hamilton brings out the ninth caution. When he lost a wheel, it rolled through the infield, caused fans to scamper, and left its mark on a Ford Expedition. Bobby Labonte was running fifth, and perhaps looking ahead to his first Winston Cup title, instead of looking ahead at the road. He piles into a stop Jerry Nadeau after numerous cars get jammed up on pit road. The 18 crew calmly made repairs and sent him back out 26th, still on the lead lap. After starting 34th, Sterling Marlin changed two tires and came out with the lead. In fact, he increased his advantage when he chopped off Dave Blaney and congested everyone behind him. No caution. Jeff Burton seemingly had the fastest car. He led the most laps, 202, and passed Marlin for the top spot on lap 306. Oh yeah, the point leader. Well, he made his way back up to ninth, but with only 22 laps to go, Mike Skinner misjudged, misinterpreted, or just didn't want to miss his chance to make the highlights. But incredibly, Bobby only lost one spot and finished 10th. After the final pit stops, Burton came out fourth. And with Stewart and Earnhardt up front, he found himself in tight traffic. In the final three circuits, Burton tried to intimidate Earnhardt for second, but that's as close as it would get. Tony Stewart wins his fifth race this season and second in a row. In the championship chase, Bobby Labonte needs an average finish of sixth in the next six races to claim the title.
This place is so tough to get around, and we won today, but I'm still not sure I've got it figured out yet. So it's one of the places that I feel like I still need to work at it, but today was a step in the right direction.
That's what it's all about, is racing for the points. And I know Bobby didn't finish far enough back to gain a whole lot, but every little bit helps. We can just keep working on it.
Last week was a real big blow to us and our effort. And then this week, wasn't a big blow. It was a big blow emotionally. But so it's been a tough couple weeks for us. I'm not whining because we finished third, because third's great. But we felt like we had a great chance to win, and we didn't get it done.
I got to live the full treatment here at Martinsville. Got to do everything, a little bit of everything this weekend, it seemed like. So, it could have been a lot worse. We've seen worse days here before.
Bobby Labonte may have salvaged a 10th place finish, but that was just enough to keep things interesting in the point standings. Dale Earnhardt's second place finish helped him gain 36 points on the leader. He now trails by 213. Jeff Burton moved from fourth to third, swapping spots with Dale Jarrett. Martinsville winner Tony Stewart sits in fifth, 162 points behind Jarrett. On the next page, it's Ricky Rudd, followed by Rusty Wallace and Mark Martin. Jeff Gordon moves up one to ninth, putting Ward Burton on the bubble. And of course, as we've said, things could have been so much worse for Bobby Labonte at Martinsville. Now he goes to Charlotte, a track where he's performed so well. But these guys cannot take anything for granted, can they?
No, they can't take anything for granted, because you never know what might pop up next. They've had some trouble in a number of recent races. At Richmond, they had a power steering problem there, but they rallied back, got a top 10 out of it. Last weekend, the wreck on pit road there and the spin out on the racetrack, and he still came back and got a top 10 finish. That's what it takes to win a championship. Robert Yates Racing, Dale Jarrett, and Todd Parrott, and them did that last year. It seemed like on days when they were going to be out of it and right, have a disastrous finish, they'd come to rally back and come back and get a top 10 or a top 5 out of it. And that's what Bobby Labonte is doing, and that's what you have to do to win championships.
That's exactly right. As Clint Eastwood said in Heartbreak Ridge, you have to adapt, you have to adjust. That's exactly what the good teams do. Every team knows that sooner or later they're going to have problems, but teams that contend for a championship, first of all, plan, second of all, prepare, third, adjust, four, strategize. That's what they do. They overcome the adversity by their own skills. Sure, luck has a lot to do with winning a championship. There's no question about that, because as Ned said, you never know what's going to happen. But when it happens, the ability to win a championship is directly related to how well you overcome that adversity. And I think that's exactly what Bobby and Joe Gibbs Racing has been doing this year.
Yeah.
Isn't it interesting, too, that Bobby Labonte has never had a top five finish at Martinsville? Go figure.
Yeah.
Now, obviously, we're going to talk to Bobby Labonte a little bit later in our show, but what about the other guys, the next guys in points, Dale Earnhardt, Jeff Burton, and Dale Jarrett? What do these guys have to do at Charlotte?
They got to win.
Yeah.
They got to go out and try to win the race. They don't need to focus on what the other drivers are doing as far as points are concerned. They don't need to focus on what Bobby Labonte is doing. They need to go out and try to win the race, and I think that's exactly what each one of them will be trying to do.
They have to ignore everybody else. They have to ignore their points. They have to ignore Bobby Labonte, and they have to say, guys, we've got nothing to lose. We've got to win. Yeah, we're in a championship hunt. We can lose that. But winning races is what we've got to do if we're going to overcome Bobby Labonte or anybody else. So let's just go out and win.
We saw Matt Kenseth do it in the spring. Could we see another first-time winner at Charlotte, perhaps?
Could very well.
Been a track.
Yeah, there's been a lot of drivers who have been so close to victory this year. Ricky Rudd, I mean, well, of course, he wouldn't be a first-time winner, but he'd be a first-time winner in a while.
Right.
Everybody's expected him to win this year, and of course, he's been running very strong recently. But, you know, you got Mike Skinner and some others
right.
who have never won that, yeah, they could break through at any time, and Charlotte race could be one of them.
Now let's look at a couple of guys that are in slumps, Mark Martin and Ward Burton. They both run very well at Charlotte, and they could win there, too, and what a boost that would be for them.
Any dark horses? Other than the guys you've already mentioned.
Here we go again.
Yeah, they're just, maybe Michael Walter. Maybe he'd be a dark horse, wouldn't he?
I think he probably would be.
Dark, he'd be a black horse. I mean, but he won the Winston.
You said it was time for him to step up. Maybe
right.
he can do it before he goes to Dale Earnhardt Incorporated. Well, coming up, meet Ryan Newman. Will he be the next Winston Cup superstar? Roger Penske seems to think so. We'll have his story when Inside NASCAR returns.
It's just always been my goal to be a Winston Cup champion and being part of the ARCA series and moving up next year to the Busch and then a part-time Winston Cup series is just a dream come true.
In the quest to find the next Jeff Gordon, Winston Cup team owners are willing to take some chances. The new trend, find raw talent to groom and develop. On Wednesday, Roger Penske officially announced his latest recruit, 22-year-old Ryan Newman. Plucked from obscurity earlier this year, this virtual unknown has shown flashes of brilliance on the track. But is this up-and-coming driver ready for what's ahead? From the first time he stepped foot inside his stock car, Ryan Newman knew it was where he was meant to be. Surprisingly enough, that was just 4 short months ago. It all started when he was introduced to motorsports mogul Roger Penske back at Daytona in February. The 1999 USAC Silver Crown champ had cut his racing teeth in open wheel cars, but had dreamed of moving to the full-bodied machine. Penske gave him the opportunity earlier this year in the ARCA series, and on Wednesday, the two announced a 23-race deal for 2001. Newman will compete in ARCA, Busch, and Winston Cup before moving to Cup full-time as a teammate to Rusty Wallace in 2002.
We didn't really think of this until after we'd really defined what we were doing, and we figured it was the ARCA, Busch, and Winston Cup schedule, so we're calling it the ABC schedule, which, you know, I guess if you figure from a young team starting out and growing up, it kind of makes sense that we start out with our ABCs, and just to be able to get laps at the Winston Cup tracks, because that is our goal in the future, the new racetracks that are coming in Chicagoland and Kansas City and the other ARCA races that are on the Winston Cup sanctioned events, like Pocono, Michigan, Talladega, Charlotte, Daytona, those are of great interest to us because those give us the opportunity to make laps and for me to learn what those racetracks are going to be like in the future.
So far, adapting to those tracks hasn't been a problem. In only 4 ARCA starts, at Michigan, Pocono, Kentucky, and Charlotte, Newman already has 3 series wins. His first victory came at Pocono in July. It was his second race in a stock car.
How much of a rush was it for you getting to victory lane in the ARCA series?
It was really neat. We had a small blemish there on our first ARCA win. We got together with the leader at the time, and you know that put a little dent in the atmosphere, let's say. But it was really neat. It was really neat to be a Winston Cup event all in the same weekend, and it's just you know something that I really look forward to, and I didn't think it would come on that day, but it did.
How have you been able to adapt so well to these stock cars and put your car in victory lane?
Got a great crew, great people around me, all the guys at the shop. I've just been welcomed in open arms to the team and the way they act and the way they treat people. It's just such a family atmosphere. And my crew chief, Matt Borland, also has a great engineering background. Seems like we have a great chemical relationship going, and that I think that's a great asset to our team.
Is he going to stay with you as you progress up through the Busch and the ARCA series next year and some Winston Cup?
Yes, and another great asset's been Buddy Baker, just to have Buddy on our side. You know, for me, he's like an eagle eye because he can watch over and see what's right from wrong. He's been doing this for a long time, and he knows, like I said, the rights and the wrongs, and he knows how to... He's given me so much confidence as a driver that it's helped me in my qualifying laps and also to race with other cars.
Newman is scheduled to run his first Winston Cup race at Phoenix in November. In the meantime, he's got some homework to do, both in the race car and at Purdue University, where he's studying engineering.
Alan Kowicki was the first driver in this series in Winston Cup racing to have a college degree. You're kind of following in his footsteps, working on your engineering degree, same degree he had. How close are you?
I'm real close. I have two classes to go. Trying to finish them up this semester. It's been really difficult with our extensive testing schedule and such, so just doing what we can because I know it's an important part of a driver's career.
How much have you been testing?
Quite a bit. We've tested at all our ARCA-based racetracks and been doing a little bit on the side just to get me laps behind the seat and feel what a tire does as it falls off and what a car does as it runs 100 laps.
Do you realize just how huge of an opportunity this is, and are you overwhelmed by the prospect that Roger Penske, of all people, has tapped you and said, this is the guy, this is the future?
It's really just a great honor, and like I said, it's a dream come true. Roger said something to me after my first win at Pocono. He says, just be humble, and I think that's just a way to approach everything that we do, is to be humble and do the best you can and not let the world affect you, because you know, we do have the greatest, I have the greatest opportunity of my life right here, and I want to make the best of it.
Well, Ryan Newman is obviously a very sharp young guy, but is this a wise move on team owners' parts to do what Roger Penske is doing and pluck some of these young guys out?
Well, I think it's very smart. It's expensive, no question about that, but I think that it's smart because without that kind of help, many drivers would never get the opportunity to show their talents. It's sort of like in the country music field. How many times have you fans out there gone to a concert somewhere of a group or a person that you've never seen or heard of before, and you performed just great and said, man, he ought to be on the Grand Ole Opry. Well, it's similar to race driving.
Oh, I say that all the time.
Yeah, I know. You don't get, you know, until you get that chance, there's no way that you can show what kind of talent that you have.
Well, you know, the developmental process is relatively new in NASCAR. Years ago, they didn't have multi-car teams or developmental processes. What's going on now is that teams are being very, very smart about their drivers. What I'm trying to say is that you've got a regular driver now, let's just name a few, a Jeff Burton, a Mark Martin. The guys like that, okay, 4 or 5 years down the road, they say, okay, we're tired of this, we want to quit. What are they going to do, go out and try to find somebody immediately to put into the car? No. The developmental process has allowed them to bring someone like a Ryan Newman and other guys that have offered the same opportunity to be already experienced and ready to go, and therefore there is no slowdown in performance.
Ned, you said it was expensive. Why?
Well, because normally you don't have the big buck sponsorship to go behind those people to bear the cost of running races that maybe you might not ordinarily run. And, you know, it takes another team and a lot of expense involved in doing that.
Well, obviously, from what we've seen so far, we're going to see a lot of great things out of Ryan Newman in the future.
Yeah.
Well, up next, we'll go over the wall with a Craftsman Truck Series pit crew. Stick around. You're watching Inside NASCAR.
Coming up, if jumping in front of a cup car seems crazy, check this out. We'll take you over the wall with Andy Houston's Truck Series crew. Plus, how demanding is the role of a NASCAR crew member? You'll get a closer look when Inside NASCAR returns.
Welcome back to Inside NASCAR. Over the past few months, we've showcased the talents of several Winston Cup pit crews. As everyone knows, good pit stops are crucial to a team's success. But is the pressure to perform the same in all three of NASCAR's top divisions? This week, we go over the wall with the number 60 Addington Motorsports Craftsman Truck Series team to find out.
I'm Tim Sanders, rear tire changer.
I'm Eric Smart, front tire changer.
I'm Houston Caldwell, jack man.
Hi, I'm Robbie Huffman, catch can man.
Chris Berger, front tire carrier.
I'm Jimmy Sprinkle, gas man.
I'm Greg Tester, rear tire carrier for the Addington Racing Cat Rental Chevrolet.
Yes,
difference is between Winston Cup and the Truck Series is two tires versus four tires.
If it's been a long run on a big track and you're out of gas, that really, really throws pressure on the gas man, because he has to get in there and get two cans of gas in, while normally they're just going to change two tires, so you better be on the mark.
I tried to stay with some of the veteran guys and learn from what they've been doing for 20 years. You know, this is my first year, and I don't know everything, you know. So these guys can really teach me a ton.
Stay working hard. Don't beat myself up over little things. Get right back into it and not stop.
A lot of times with advice, you almost have to live your own hard knocks before you really realize what that advice was, how that advice affected you, or how good it was, really. You look back a lot of times and say, I should have listened.
Fun for me is jumping over the wall. That's what I go to the racetrack for.
It's a lot of fun. It's real not stressful at all.
This is so much more fun. Not as much pressure, but it's a little bit more intense for a gas man on a truck team.
The races are shorter, get Sundays off, probably the biggest difference. Coming up to the Truck Series, it's a ton more responsibilities, and, you know, but we get paid to play with race cars, so that's pretty fun.
Get ready as soon as we hear the truck's going to be coming in. Just get up on the wall and wait for it to come in and do my job. Just try and take everything out of my head, you know, except for watching for those lug nuts as soon as I get around to the side of the truck.
I kind of meditate a little bit. I'll close my eyes and focus on five lugs and go through a pit stop, you know, with my eyes shut.
Five pits away, I focus on the gas nozzle itself. And from there on in, I don't even see anybody leave the wall. I don't see the tire changers leave. I just looking at that hole, and as soon as it's there, I hit it.
Pulling was great. Come from behind, got tore up, and passing the last lap, everybody's run out of gas. I also build fuel cells, so that's, I'm standing back here chomping a bit. You know, don't run out.
Everybody stayed focused. Andy stayed focused for, and we come out a winner.
Portland was not real a surprise to me. I always wanted to win a road race. It's a hard thing to describe, you know. To win a race is wonderful. That's what all your time and effort's for, is to win a race.
Hey, when they talk about the Craftsman Truck Series being fun, I think what it means is that the Craftsman Truck Series today is what the Winston Cup Series used to be several years ago. Now, there's not a thing wrong with the Winston Cup Series today, but let's face it, it can be a real pressure cooker. There's a lot of money involved. It's huge in popularity. There's a lot of eyes on the competitors that they want to do well, so it's become somewhat of a different sport. It's a lot more laid back in the Craftsman Truck Series. That's what the Winston Cup Series used to be. So I think that's why those guys say it can be fun. But, Ned, it can be something else, too.
Yes, it can be. It can be a good proving ground for these driver training ground for these crew members to get experience so they can move on to Winston Cup if that is their desire. Some of them will be content to stay there forever in this kind of an environment because of the fun that is involved. But certainly if they plan to move on, it's a good learning curve for them. They can get the experience that they need for Winston Cup racing, and we'll see many of them move on.
Well, hats off to those guys, because it does take a lot of talent to be on a pit crew. Yeah. Many guys on the pit crew also work in the shop during the week. This double duty definitely takes its toll. Coming up, we'll take a closer look at life as a Winston Cup crew member. Don't go away. Inside NASCAR will be right back.
This week, we backtrack to Charlotte Motor Speedway for race number 52, the National 400. After 10 lead changes in the 267-lap contest, Junior Johnson came home the winner. He cashed in on $11,000, his only win in the season. The Charlotte crowd also witnessed Joe Weatherly clinch the season's championship. What year was it? 1962, 1963, or 1964?
TNN looks at now. NASCAR 2000 and the future of watching a race.
The racetrack used to be the only place to see stock car racing until television brought it to a wider audience. What's on the horizon to change how fans watch a race?
We go to the NASCAR channel about 5 o'clock and find out what's happening. You're watching all this on high definition television. And you also have got your computer integrated into the TV at this point. You go over to DirecTV, and for $9.95, you actually race in the race.
From real-time racing to monitoring driver and crew radio contact, fans have more and more opportunity to interact and control their own view of the race. For more on NASCAR 2000, log on to country.com, your personal source for all things country.
Brought to you by Fran, who asks, when was the last time you changed your air filter? Junior Johnson was the class of the field in the National 400 at Charlotte. After starting third, he took the lead for the final time on lap 196. He took the checkers and $11,000, while Joe Weatherly took home the Grand National Championship on October 14th, 1962.
Life as a Winston Cup crew member is far from easy. Long hours, time away from home, and lots of stress are just part of the job. And to make things even tougher, NASCAR has released its 2001 schedule, which includes 2 additional race dates. Despite the demands, these guys still manage to stay focused, pushing it to the limit in order to win.
Girls head back when you least expect, where you most regret it.
You got to be away from your family so much, and these guys are like your family. You're with them more than you are your family, so you got to get along.
We enjoy being with each other. We go out to dinner all the time. It's just, we like being around each other. It's like brothers.
To these guys on the road that their wives aren't in racing, I feel sorry for them because I still don't spend enough time with her.
It's very, very tough to keep everything pointed the same direction and still make sure that they can either see their wife and kids on occasion so we don't have everybody divorced and everybody unhappy.
Life on the road. It's tough on marriages, on families, on your body and your mind. But for the nomads who make up the traveling circus known as NASCAR Winston Cup Racing, it's the only life they know. No one feels the demands of that lifestyle more than the guys who work on the teams. The hours are extremely long. One day off a week is a luxury. And always there's the pressure to put together the best piece possible for your driver.
You're putting your life in these guys' hands, and these guys are preparing the cars that you're going out there going 200 miles an hour in. So you want to have the relationship that builds trust in your crew guys and trust in the people that are preparing the cars for you so that you can go out there and perform at 100% and not worry about how the cars are prepared or how they're put together.
The trick is sustaining that level of perfection for an incredible length of time in an environment that keeps you away from home and makes balancing a personal life difficult. And it's only getting worse. Next season, there are 38 scheduled race weekends, 36 points events, and 2 non-points races. That includes a stretch of 20 straight weeks in the second half of the season and doesn't even factor in testing. Team owners have made some positive changes trying to soften the blow. The salaries for crew members are at an all-time high, and most teams have impressive bonus programs that reward their employees for performance. Definite steps in the right direction, but they only go so far.
It's surpassed money. You know, you can pay people ever how much you want to pay them, but you're going to burn them out at some point. Nobody can go 100% all the time.
I would like to see them go home and spend quality time with their families, the guys that have them, the guys that don't, go home, do what they choose to do. Like I say, this is not everything. It's just what we do for a living.
One way teams could give their employees more time is to increase the number of positions, splitting up jobs to tackle the overwhelming load.
doubling up on some of these positions are going to be essential. We're just going to have to do it. Bite the bullet, add it into the salary budget, and live with it, work around it. We've discussed it at length that there are certain positions, certain road positions, that are going to have to be doubled up, and some people are just going to have to maybe miss some weekends to get themselves, kind of get their batteries recharged for the late race, late in the year race stretch run.
But that could seriously drive up the cost to team owners, not to mention the fact that when you start alternating road crews, you start tampering with your formula.
A lot of what this is the driver having confidence in what he's driving. I mean, he can't go that fast and not have confidence in the people that he's working with. So I think you still have to have that same group of guys on the road, you know, constantly. Yeah, I mean, they're trying to do stuff to try to get sophomore days in the shop, like get more shop help and, you know, and things like that. But as far as the racetrack, I think that you need the same guys at the racetrack every week.
So if being away from home is a necessity, then why do these guys do it? Well, first, there's the love of competition, along with the self-satisfaction of a job well done. And then there's that other thing. A lot of people would say you guys are crazy. What do you say to that?
Well, we probably are. I pretty much know that we are. when you do it, as long as most of us have done it and still love to do it, something can't be right.
Well, Ned, obviously there is a real problem here. You've got to keep these guys from getting totally burnt out. What do you think the answer is?
Well, I think one thing they're going to have to look at is maybe giving those that are on the road more time off as opposed to going to the shop and working every day like they have in the past. Give them a little bit of time. They got to have time to spend with their family. They got to have time to do everyday type things that we're all involved in. And they just haven't had much of that. And when you add a couple more races onto the schedule, it's going to even get worse. So I think that's one adjustment that will need to be made.
And giving them the time off means that you're probably going to have to add guys at the shop. So the guys at the shop will take the load off the guys who go on the road. That's going to mean more expense. There's no doubt about that. However, it might be something of a trade-off when it comes to expense because there's going to be more money to be made next year. The television package alone guarantees that, so there might be a little bit of trade-off in expense. But I don't care about that, guys. It doesn't matter about money. Money ain't going to keep your tongue from hanging out when you're wore out.
No, that's true.
But as these guys said, you have to love it and you have to get along with each other in order to be successful, and these guys wouldn't be in the position they're in if they didn't.
That's right.
Well, straight ahead, the Joe Gibbs Express is building up steam. Can anyone derail this train? Bobby Labonte in focus next on Inside NASCAR.
Closed captioning provided by Meineke Discount Mufflers, where you won't pay a lot, but you'll always get a lot. The Inside NASCAR In Focus Conversation is brought to you by Valvoline Max Life, the first motor oil specifically formulated for higher mileage engines.
Welcome back to Inside NASCAR. 19 races ago, Bobby Labonte took over the Winston Cup points lead at California. Now heading down the home stretch, he has a 213-point lead over runner-up Dale Earnhardt. At this point, it would take a major catastrophe to loosen Labonte's grip on the championship, but the Texas native still guards his optimism and isn't going to coast to the finish line just yet.
Jeremy Mayfield takes the Napa Auto Parts 500 in California.
Bobby Labonte should have recaptured the NASCAR Winston Cup point lead. He comes home second.
Checkered flag, and Stewart takes the NBNA Platinum 400. Bobby Labonte protecting most of his championship lead with a third-place effort. Wallace to the stripe, checkered flag. He wins the Pepsi 400 at the Michigan Speedway. Bobby Labonte finishes third.
It is just desserts for Jeff Burton as he has dominated this field. In tow behind the pace car, one corner away from pitching a perfect game at New Hampshire.
You lead every lap, you win the race, you look up and there's Bobby Labonte, you know, running second, so.
Well, Bobby, it seems every time you open up a newspaper these days to the sports section, the headlines read something to the effect of Labonte poised to win first Winston Cup title. How much pressure does that carry?
Well, I think it's, the way we look at it at Joe Gibbs Racing is that it's still a long ways from being over. And sure, anybody could beat us, our plan is just to go out there like we have been and try to run these races no differently than we have, which has got us a good average finish for the year, which is good enough to win, you know, a points championship, you might say. So, you know, hopefully we can just go out there and do that. I mean, that's our goal from here on out, is to do what we've been doing. And, you know, we just got to be smart about it. And you know, hope it just comes from, you know, all year long, you just get a little smarter and smarter. And if everything works out, then it works out.
you've been the point leader in 25 of the last 26 weeks, and really you've become the hunted as opposed to the hunter for the first time in your career. With that, can you describe the atmosphere that this team has been in and how that has affected your strategy?
Last year, chasing Dale Jarrett towards the end of the year, you might take more chances, of course. You're trying to catch up. You're trying to make the break that might help you. If you don't want to wish bad luck on people, but if he did have a break, you want to make sure you're there to capitalize. Okay, now, being hunted all the time, you don't really drive much different. When you get down towards the end of the year, I mean, it is a little different because you got guys, the difference is not on our part as much as it is on everybody else's, because they are hungrier because they're behind. They want to get caught up. They don't want to wish you no bad luck, maybe, but if you do, they want to take advantage of it. You know, if you do have a problem, they want to take advantage of it. So they're running hard. I mean, running real hard. And so it's hard to outrun them, on a given basis. Now they're running they got a little extra momentum there or extra something they want to try. And that they all run good. All run good to begin with. Now it seems like they all run better.
And they are swinging for the fences, and sometimes they strike out. But you've been able to capitalize on that. Dover is a prime example.
It was, and we had a good car at Dover. We didn't have a great car at Dover, but we had one that was fast enough to be in the top five. And we ended up in the top five, and, given a couple breaks, we might have been third. So, I also look at it, we could have been 29th. So I was going to take that top five as being a real successful day for us. And we capitalized on somebody else's misfortune. So there's going to be days where we're going to have that misfortune. They're going to capitalize on it. And we're going to have to sit there and grit our teeth and go to the next one.
One of the major assets of this team has to be Joe Gibbs. He knows what it means to be in a title run. He's won multiple Super Bowl championships in the NFL. How much of a factor has he been with this team this year, trying to keep you guys focused?
But he hasn't really changed a whole lot. I mean, his focus is still just like it was on day one. You got to do everything you can to win a championship. You know, he's going to give everything he's got to win a championship. And the fact that he's been there in a different league, but in the same scenario of things, that does help us out, because there's confidence that he has that he can bring to the team that we might not know with his experience that helps us out.
Your brother Terry is a two-time Winston Cup Series champion. When he won his first title in 1984, you were just 20, 21 years old. What were your thoughts? How did you look at that?
I felt so good for him, just because family, and just thought that was the neatest thing, because I was working on the car that, was able to win a championship and be a small part of a team that won the championship. I've seen Terry race his 57 Chevys in Corpus Christi, and saw him race late models against guys up in Houston and then Winston Cup, and then got to fortunate enough to get a job there and do that small things that I was able to do and go to New York and celebrate and be just like a, by golly, on a Winston Cup race team,
And I know you don't need any additional incentive to go after the title this year, but knowing the fact that if you were to capture the championship, you and Terry would become the first brother combination to win a Winston Cup title. Would that make it any more special?
If it happens, it happens. I think that's when it'll be special. But who it would be the most special for is our parents. You look at it from their point of view when they're sitting back watching TV on the couch with the feet propped up on the coffee table. They're thinking and they're watching the show and that was announced and that happened. Those are the people that would be, to me, those are the ones that are going to be the proudest. I mean, Terry and I, we're going to be happy, but I think our parents would be, to say that they've been a part of this accomplishment too. I think that's what would really be neat. But it would be neat for us, but it would be really neat for them.
Well, we can only probably begin to imagine how special it would be for the Labonte family to have two brothers as champions in the NASCAR Winston Cup Series. But, Ned, I guess maybe you could give us a sense of that. At least you've experienced the father-son champions.
Well, that was very special, I can tell you that. We were the second father-son to have accomplished that. The Pettis, of course, were the first to do that. But it would be special to see the Labontes accomplish that. They come from a great racing family. Their father, Bob Labonte, has been involved in the sport for a long, long time. And they have done nothing but good things in the sport. They've been good on the racetrack. Both Terry and Bobby have been. And also, they've been good off the racetrack. They build a tremendous family type of an image, sort of a quiet type of an image, but that's good. And I think he would make a great champion. And it's good to see him finally maybe realizing that he's in the battle for the championship. You know, for so long, yep. Bobby would say, hey, we're not focusing on points. We're not thinking about the championship. We're just going out doing our thing in each race. But now he's beginning to realize, hey, that I better start thinking about this because it might happen. I might be the NASCAR Winston Cup champion, and there's a lot of planning that has to be done between now and December at the awards banquet, like picking the band for the reception
yeah, the
party,
important
those kind
things
of things.
In life. Yeah.
Could come from the Grand Ole Opry there, Ned.
Hey, that'd be good.
I don't think so, not with Bobby Labonte. I've heard about the band that he's hoping to get, but you can't think about that. He's not thinking about the championship yet.
No, of course not. He's in a position right now where he can be cautious for the final races of the year. The guys that are chasing him, they got to throw caution to the wind. And being cautious is probably going to help Bobby's record. He has not had a DNF this year. Out of 8,418 laps run prior to the Charlotte race, he's only failed to finish eighth. That's incredible.
That is amazing. Well, there's still more Inside NASCAR coming up. Stay with us.
The Inside NASCAR mailbox is brought to you by NASCAR Winston Cup Scene. Our question this week is from Janet Hall of Mount Vernon, Illinois. What is the difference between the oil I use in my car and the oil used in a Winston Cup car?
I'm Robert Van Norman with Safety Clean Motorsports. The oil that is used in the NASCAR Winston Cup, Busch Grand National, and Craftsman Truck Series is exactly the same oil that you use in your personal car at home. The viscosity may vary between qualifying and racing, but most teams run 20 W50 race oil for the actual event. Thanks for writing in.
If you have a question for the Inside NASCAR mailbox, email us at this address or write us at Inside NASCAR, Post Office Box 240417, Charlotte, North Carolina 28224. If we use your question on the air, you'll receive a one-year subscription to NASCAR Winston Cup Scene, the nation's largest weekly automotive racing newspaper, and a cap and shirt from Chase Authentics, the authentic trackside apparel of NASCAR.
Well, Ned, Steve, of course, everyone is focused on Charlotte this weekend, but next weekend we head to Talladega, and it could be an entirely different ball game.
Yes, it could be. New rules in effect down there next week, a bigger, stricter plate, and of course they got some things on the race cars to slow them down. And been a lot of testing has gone on down there, but no one really knows how it's going to work in the race. It could be very interesting.
Yeah, the race is going to be a big mystery, you know, with all the gee-gaws and frou-frous and whatnots they put on the cars for
this.
Yeah, really. You know, you don't really know what's going to happen, but from what I hear from testing, the drivers seem to be pretty pleased. They have picked up some throttle speed and some passing has been going on, so that could make it a real good Talladega race.
Look forward to it.
Yeah, we've talked to some of the drivers about their experiences and what they think about the rules changes, and we're going to see that on next week's show.
Good.
Well, that's all the time we have for this edition of Inside NASCAR. As always, thanks for watching, and be sure to join us each weekend at our new times, Saturday at 5 and Sunday morning at 9 Eastern. So long, everybody.
Inside NASCAR has been brought to you by Valvoline Max Life, the first motor oil specifically formulated for higher mileage engines. New for all race fan families and racing kids, introducing the Simpson Child Care Safety Seat. For more information, visit our website at SimpsonRaceProducts.com or call 1-800-473-7077. Communications provided by Racing Radios, the two-way radio provider of the NASCAR Winston Cup Series, Busch Series, and Craftsman Truck Series. Featherlight, the official luxury motor coach of NASCAR, CART, IRL, and NHRA. Remember to call Featherlight for all your motor coach and trailer needs at 800-800-1230.